Before I start, I asked the brothers and sisters to recite Fatiha for our dear departed brother Haj Hassan Bazzi, Rahmatullah alayh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yataghammadahu bi rahmatihi alwasi'a wa yahshuruhu ma'a Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Al-Fatiha qablaha as-salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين وحجة رب العالمين المنتجب في الميثاق المصطفى في الظلال المطهر من كل آفة البرية من كل عيب المؤمل للنجاة المرتجى للشفاعة المفوض إليه دين الله. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك وأناخت برحلك. عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى أخته العقيلة عقيلة الطالبيين زينب الكبرى وأخيه أبا الفضل العباس ورحمة الله وبركاته. يا أبا الحسن يا موسى بن جعفر يا سيدي ومولاي أيها الكاظم يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله. قال الإمام موسى بن جعفر الكاظم عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام: من أراد أن يكون أقوى الناس فليتوكل على الله. For the hasty appearance of Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman, arwahuna wa arwahu al-alamin lituraba maqdamihi al-fida aloud salawat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses the prophets and chooses the imams without any interference from any man, any woman. They are chosen by God by God the Almighty alone, divinely chosen by God the Almighty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for every imam that we have, also gave a task, and they also have a legacy that is dedicated for them for that time and that period. When it comes to the prophets, you see the similar with the prophets. Everyone is known for something that it's relevant for that time period as well. For example, when it comes to the imams, for Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi afdhalus salati was salam, Amir al-Mu'mineen, of course, you can't bound it in one or two paragraphs. There is way too many things to talk about, and his legacy is beyond one lecture or two lectures or one book or two books, but just some pointers here and there. You find Amir al-Mu'mineen is known for his courage, Amir al-Mu'mineen is known for his bravery, Amir al-Mu'mineen is known for his eloquency. And it comes to the other imams, to Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. Alongside to that, you also find that they also have a tragedy that is allocated to them. Why? Because you, as a Shia, as a follower of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi afdhalus salati wassalam, alayhim afdhalus salati wassalam, when you come and you say that my imams live this kind of a life, well, they also saw hardship. So when a person sees hardship, and he sees the hardship of Imam al-Hussein. He sees the hardship of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, the Imam that was imprisoned in the dungeons of Harun al-Abbasi and Mahdi al-Abbasi for many years. So a person comes to this point and he says, we as a Shia, when we see many tragedies, we can see the connecting points to the Imams. They also saw many tragedies. That means that the Imam doesn't live a life of full comfort. For example, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, after the martyrdom of his father, Mansur al-Abbasi, alayhi la'ainullah, one of the Abbasides, Khalifa, Caliph, and you know Mansur, the Abbasides, they are the cousins of the Imams. And they came into power saying to the people that we come into power to give the rights to the family of Ahlul Bayt, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when they came into power, you see definitely they are the enemies. They have more hate toward Ahlul Bayt than the Umayyads. The Umayyads, they ruled the Islamic Empire less than 100 years, 99 point something years, the Umayyads, they ruled the Islamic Empire. And then when it comes to the Abbasids, more than 500 years, up to 700 years, the Abbasids, they ruled the Islamic Empire to the point that Baghdad was conquered, fell to the hands of Hulako, one of the sons of Genghis Khan. You find them having this life of sins, drinking, and adultery, and so on and so forth. They claim that they are the cousins of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that gives them the right to rule the Islamic Empire. That's what Harun had in his mind, because I'm one of the cousins of the Prophet. We are the inheritors of the Prophet. Mansur al-Abbasi. Mansur is before Harun al-Abbasi. Mansur is first in the time of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. And then after Mansur comes Mahdi al-Abbasi. After Mahdi al-Abbasi comes Harun al-Abbasi, aka Harun al-Rashid. And he wasn't a Rashid. We know him as Harun al-Abbasi. Mansur, when he heard that Imam al-Sadiq has died, he said three times, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un," even though he's the one who poisoned the Imam. And then he said to his messenger, "Find out who is taking over after Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq. Bring him over and decapitate him." Imam As-Sadiq alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, in his wasiyyah, and here you have to learn and understand and study the ways of the Imams to comprehend how they lived their lives and how they treated the enemies. The Imam here put the names of five people as his inheritor. One of the five is his inheritor. A true Shia knows which one is which. But a person like Mansur or the Wali of Medina, who had this task to kill the inheritor of Imam As-Sadiq, doesn't know. So قَدْ أَوْصَى إِلَىٰ خَمْسَةٍ. There are five of them. The Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad As-Sadiq, he had put their names on the list. One of them, أَحَدُهُمْ أَبُو جَعْفَرَ الْمَنْصُورِ. Imam al-Sadiq had just done down. The first one is Mansur himself, is my inheritor. He will take over after me. Second one is Abdullah al-Aftah. Abdullah al-Aftah, he's the son of Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq. And he's not just the son of the Imam, he's older than Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. He's older than Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. He was known as Abdullah al-Aftah. That's the second one. The third of them was
The Wali of Medina, the governor of Medina, who had the task to kill the one who inherits the Imam. The fourth was Hamida or Humayda al-Musaffat, the mother of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. And the last one is who? Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. So these five. Whoever comes from, you know, outside of Shia sect, and they come outside of that circle, they start asking questions. Is it Abu Ja'far al-Mansur al-Dawaniqi? Is it the governor of Medina? Is it Hamida al-Musaffa or Humayda al-Musaffa? Or is it Abdullah al-Aftah? Let's go through them. First in first, these two, the governor of Medina and Abu Ja'far Mansur al-Dawaniqi, they can't be imams after Imam al-Sadiq. Why? Because they are tyrants. A tyrant, an oppressor, can't be an imam, can they? No. So these two, you cross them over, they're out. Third one, you come to Abdullah al-Aftah. He's older than Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, but you can't consider him as an imam. Why? Because he was disabled with his legs. He had disability in his legs. And we as a Shia, we believe that imam and imam has to be complete, 100%, physically and mentally. Physically and mentally. So a person, if he comes here, a person comes into this mosque and claims to be Imam Al-Hujjah, alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, and he can't see in with one eye. A'war. Yes? With one eye, has a patch. He said, straight away, you're not an imam. Why? Because you're disabled. Or mentally, if that person has any mental problems or impairment, that person is not an imam. Abdullah al-Aftah, even though he was older than Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, he can't be an imam because he has disability. He has a disabled legs. That's also another person who you cross over. So now three are out of the picture. You come to a lady, even though this lady was the mother of Imam al-Kadhim, Hamida al-Musaffat, alayhi salam, you can't consider her as what? An imam after Imam al-Kadhim. Imam al-Sadiq. Why? Because she's a lady, a woman, and a woman cannot be imam. Then you end up to Imam al-Kadhim. Imam al-Kadhim is the one. But that wasiyya brought down to the knees Mansur al-Dawaniqi, because Mansur al-Dawaniqi, when he saw this, he said, don't worry about it. Just consider it as ignored. Let them be, because we don't know who's going to take over. Because his name is on the list. And he had ordered whoever is on the list to be killed. He's going to be the first one to be killed, Mansur, and then the governor, and the rest of them. So this is an important part of that, to see that the Imam Sadiq, knows how to put on Imam al-Kadhim as the imam to take over after him. Now, Imam al-Kadhim himself, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa alaykum as-salam, give us the chance to visit this imam. There are many ahadith of this imam, and the legacy of this imam is beyond one lecture. I wanted to mention one of the ahadith, and we send this hadith, inshallah, the thawab of this majlis, to our dear brother, the newly departed Hajj Hassan al-Bazzi, inshallah. So one of the ahadith that Imam al-Kadhim has mentioned is this hadith, and this is a beautiful hadith. He said, Imam al-Kadhim, قال الإمام موسى بن جعفر عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام وجدت علم الناس في أربع أولها أن تعرف ربك. I have found the ilm, the knowledge of people in four. One, to know your God. And that's very important, especially for the youngsters here, for the Shabab and the Shabbat upstairs. You need to know your God. Need to know your God. Now, in Quran al-Kareem, we have the hawiyya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hawiyya, I mean, who God is.
Where in which surah? Surah Al-Ikhlas. Surah قل هو الله أحد. Because we as Muslims, we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the absolute creator. Especially when you live in a Western society, in a Western country, they like to give you the illustration of a person who they want you to believe in and worship. And that can be anyone. It can be Jesus, can be one of the gods of Hindus, one of the gods of the Buddhists, whoever. They choose for that person to be your God. But when it comes to Muslims, when it comes to Islam, Surah Al-Ikhlas is one of the surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes who he is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the Prophet was asked, tell us who God is, because you telling us that leave all your false gods, that's what the Prophet was saying to the Arabs, leave all your false gods, gods that were made by our own hands, gods made with metal, made with wood, made with clay, leave them, that we see them, we can touch them, and believe in a God that we don't see, that is invisible. How can this be? They came to the Prophet and they asked his questions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the Archangel Jibreel and says to Archangel Jibreel, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Allah is one, and there cannot be another God allocated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you do that, you become a mushrik. A mushrik means a polytheist. Coming out of the monotheism into polytheism. And that's not right. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. أَحَدٌ means one, and one only one. اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ. صَمَدُ means what? Allah doesn't need anything. I need to drink water because my mouth goes dry. I need to eat because I become hungry. I need to sleep because I become tired. I need all of this because I'm a human being that is always in need. I'm hot, I'm cold, always in need of something. But Allah is samad. Allah doesn't need anything. Allah is samad. And then Allah says here, lam yalid wa lam yulad. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. Nor was he begotten, nor does he begot anyone. That means he doesn't have children, nor does he have any parents. Because if you come and say Allah has parents, nastajiru billah, and you say this kufr, then Allah himself can have children. We have a whole family of gods. And that, can that be true? No. Because when you come, for example, to the Hinduism, and you ask them about their gods, they tell you we have indefinite numbers of gods. Billions, in billions. Alaykum as-salam. So in billions, okay? So Allah as-samad lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufwan ahad. Kufwan ahad means what? You cannot compare with God any other person. Anyone. I don't know if you heard the brain surgeon who has they taken to court these recent days. He was saying that my hands are the hands of God. Sometimes, you know, we human beings, we say some things because Allah has given us some, you know, power or some ability, ahsantum, to do such and such. We go overboard. We go overboard. And this person, he's a surgeon, brain surgeon, neurosurgeon. He was saying, I'm God, or my hands are hands of God because I put on many people are back to life, and he was telling this victim's family that 3 days, you know, they will be back, they will be good. This person, nastajiru billah, some people, they have these ideas. So that's the first one, to know your God. This is a hadith from Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kalam. The second one, وَالثَّانِيَ أَن تَعْرِفَ مَا صَنَعَ بِكَ. What has he done to you? And the third one is, وَالثَّالِثَ أَن تَعْرِفَ مَا أَرَادَ مِنْكَ. What does he want from you? That's a question we always have to ask ourselves. When we wake up in the morning until the time we go to sleep, what is it required of me? What do I have to do? Because many people, they think their life is
What? Nothing. For nothing, for no reason. And they just waste minutes after minutes soaking and thinking of the past. And they don't think of how can I make something out of my life. Put a print on this life of our of mine that I live in it in this life. So here, وَالثَّالِثَ أَن تَعْرَفَ مَا أَرَادَ مِنْكَ. So what is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you? And that's a question you ask the shabab. What is it that you think Allah wants from you? You can answer. Now, praying is one of them, ahsan. But is it only praying? Huh? Test us, yes. Submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibadah, yet he said praying. Ibadah, praying, worship. What else? Shaitan had submission, but shaitan didn't have one thing. What was it? Obedience. Because there are a lot of people that have submission, but there is no obedience afterward. Is that right or not right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Wa alaykum as-salam. Obedience. Shaitan, up to that point, he was praying. See, ibadah. You listening? Was he praying or not? Well, he wasn't praying. He was praying, Shaitan. He was praying. He was known as Tawus al-Malaika. You know what Tawus al-Malaika means? Tawus means peacock of the angels. Tawus al-Malaika. Who? Shaitan, Iblis. Amir al-Mu'mineen says about Shaitan, about Iblis, he says that one sajda of Iblis took him more than 600 years. One sajda. This is a hadith. One sajda of Shaitan. To the point Allah created Adam. Allah created Adam. That same Shaitan, Iblis, al-Abalise, Tawus al-Malaika. Up to that point, he was Abid, Zahid. Allah said, bow down before Adam. He said, no. خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَار وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن طِين. You understand? No obedience here. فَتَكَبَّر. فَأَبَى. أَبَى وَتَكَبَّر. He said, no. Allah says to him, I have ordered you to do such. No. And then history repeated itself later on in Ghadir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, I have selected who? Amir al-Mu'min, Ali ibn Abi Talib as your successor. Raise your hand and say, Man kuntu mawla, fahada aliyun mawla. He does this in front of 110,000 Muslims. Some of them, they come, Ya Rasulullah. See, some of them, that's what they say to Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, you told us to pray. Listen to this. We prayed. Sallayna. قلت لنا صلوا فصلينا زكوا فزكينا. You told us to pay zakat. We paid zakat. You told us to go to umrah, to hajj. We did that. You told us all of this. It wasn't enough until you brought your cousin and your son-in-law, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and you appointed him as your successor. Is this from you or from God? See the way they talk to the Prophet, the disrespect. هل هذا من عندك أم من الله? Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, of course this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لن ينطق إلا من الله عز وجل. It's only from God the Almighty. إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered me to put Ali as my successor. This is the order from God the Almighty. This person didn't like it. To this point, I'm a Muslim. He said, after this, I'm not longer a Muslim. May Allah bring azab on me. And this is in Quran al-Kareem. That he asked Allah to throw down or send to him azab. And Allah did that. Killed him on the spot. So here, وَالثَّالِثَ أَن تَعْرِفَ مَا أَرَادَ مِنْكَ. You have to know what Allah wants from you. Same thing now, again repeats itself with Harun. Harun al-Abbasi goes to ziyarah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he's the cousin of Rasulullah.
And then he enters the shrine of Rasulullah and he calls out loud, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. As-salamu alayka ya ibn Ammah. As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Oh Rasulullah, as-salamu alaykum. Peace be upon you. Peace be upon you, O cousin. But he wants to show the people that I'm really a relative of Rasulullah. He enters the shrine, he does the ziyarah. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim comes right after him and he says this, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah, as-salamu alayka ya Jaddah. Harun looks at the Imam, Jaddah, grandfather. He says to the Imam, What did you just say? He said, yes, Jaddah, he's my grandfather. He said, how can you say such a thing? Jaddah. Couple of things here, he asked the Imam. One, how can you be his grandson? And the Imam here answers him. He says, Isa, how could Isa be son of Maryam? Allah says in the Quran, Kareem, Isa ibn Maryam. Allah here puts in Isa as son of Maryam. And we are the sons of Fatima al-Zahra. Fatima al-Zahra is the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's one. Second one, here he asked a question from Harun. He says, oh Harun, Harun al-Abbasi. He says, Harun, if Rasulullah comes today and he proposes to your daughter, wants the hands of your daughter for marriage, would you give your daughter to Rasulullah, for Rasulullah to marry her? He says, of course. It will be an honor for me. Harun says that to the Imam. I will become the uncle of Rasulullah, the father-in-law of Rasulullah, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Imam here says to him, but if the Prophet asks me, and the Prophet will not ask me, the Imam says to him, he's not going to ask me. But if he asks me, I will refuse that. I deny. I decline it. He said, how come? See? He said, of course, because my daughter is the granddaughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I can't give my daughter, the granddaughter of Rasulullah, to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Here, Harun al-Abbasi alayhi la'ainullah said to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, I apologize to you for what I'm about to do. And he had the intention to put the Imam in the dungeon. In the tamura, one tamura after the next, one tamura after the next. When I say tamura, the dungeons, a hole in the ground that they put a person in it. That's what tamura is, that you can't tell if it's day or night. You can't tell if it was day or night. The Hassanis, the sons of Imam al-Hassan, because the Abbasides, they had this animosity toward the Hassanis, they had left them in the Tamura, in the dungeons. Many of them, 10, 15, 20 sometimes. And they didn't know if it was day or night. How can they tell it's Salah time? They had this system. They recite Quran al-Kareem, and from the ajza of the Quran al-Kareem, they tell, now is Salat al-Fajr, now is Salat al-Dhuhr, now is Salat al-Asr, now is Salat al-Maghrib and Isha, or they combine them, Dhuhr and Asr, Maghrib and Isha. One of them dies, stays there until they rot. The second one dies, stays there until they rot. Until they all die, they come. Harun had given the order, if they all die and you call them, no one answers, just put dirt on them and bury them alive. That's how they treated the Hassanis, the Abbasides. That's why Baghdad today, if you go to Baghdad, Baghdad has this history. The Abbasids, they built Baghdad on the bones and the bodies of Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdalus salati was salam. That's why many of the Muslimin, many of the Shia, they loathe Baghdad. They don't like Baghdad. It's known from that day. Now Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim, he's been taken into this Tamura, dungeons, to the point the Imam says, and because of the time I recite to you this, one after the other, they come and they torture the Imam, different ways. And the Imam has chains around his legs, and he bleeds from his legs. And they come and they hit the Imam. They hit him with lashes.
لما حبس هارون الرشيد موسى بن جعفر جن عليه الليل. There is a dua of the Imam that he recites here. The Imam عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام come to this point. He comes to this point that he had enough. Years after years, he's living in these dungeons that he can't tell the day from night. He recites this dua. After he prays as-salat, he recites, Ya Sayyidi, Ya Sayyidi, Ya Mawlai, Khallisni min yadi Harun, Ya Mukhallis al-Shajar min bayn ramlin watin, wa ma'in, wa ya mukhallis al-Laban min bayn farthin wa dam, ويا مخلص الولد من بين مشيمة ورحم ويا مخلص النار من بين الحديد والحجر ويا مخلص الروح من بين الأحشاء والأمعاء خلصني من يد هارون. These days a person comes to the Imam and he says to the Imam, سيدي ومولاي, I'm one of the Shia of you. When is the Faraj? When you're coming out of this dungeon, we want to see you, we want to come to you, see you face to face, ask questions of you. The Imam says to them, in couple of days you see me on Jisr al-Baghdad. This person says, I was standing next to the Jisr al-Baghdad, I saw four men coming and they carrying a coffin, and this coffin has in it a body. They come and they place that body on the bridge of Baghdad. One of them calls out, come and see your Imam, Imam al-Rafada. I went and I looked. There is a piece of clothing on the body, on the face of that prisoner. I took it over. I lifted the sheet. I saw that it is the Imam, our seventh Imam, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kadhim. I see that the Imam is laying the dead. While I was there, sitting next to the body of the Imam, I saw one of my friends who was a doctor, a Christian doctor. I called him over. I said to him, come. He came. I said to him, can you examine this body and tell me the cause of death? He took the hands of the Imam. He started looking at the face of the Imam and his hands. And then he called out. He said to me, does this man have any family, any tribe? I said to him, why? He said, so they can ask for his blood. Because this man was killed poisonous. رحم الله من نادى وإماما وسيدا ومظلوما. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك وأناخت برحلك. عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار. ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين
وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى أخته العقيلة عقيلة الطالبين زينب الكبرى وأخيه أبا الفضل العباس ورحمة الله وبركاته. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج، اللهم عجل فرجه، سهل مخرجه، اجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه يا رب العالمين. الفاتحة على روح المؤمنين والمؤمنات، بالأخص على روح المرحوم الحاج حسن بزي. اللهم تغمده برحمتك الواسعة، اللهم أسكنه فسيح جناتك يا رب العالمين. الفاتحة قبلها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.